谷川岳、トマの耳前です。安全に。
Time. the mass of the sun orbiting each other and eventually spiraling in and merging. And that's a very violent event from the point of view of space-time. It sends out these ripples of space-time, which were observed by the LIGO using these two huge detectors, one in Washington State, the other in Louisiana. This is quite exciting, and LIGO is going to turn on again later this year. And we realized that LIGO was going to be turning on last year, and so we formed a project using our camera and our survey such that when LIGO said, they, gee, we think we maybe have seen something, we would go and point our camera in the direction of the sky where they thought it was coming from and see if we could see an optical light counterpart to these gravity waves. Now, the problem is that with only two detectors, one in Washington and one in Louisiana, they couldn't determine very precisely where on the sky these gravity waves were coming from. To triangulate, to really determine the direction precisely, you need three points of a triangle. They only had two. And so they had a rather large uncertainty of where on the sky this was. And so within a couple of days, we pointed our camera at the most likely region of sky where LIGO said they thought they saw this event. And we were searching for an optical counterpart. We didn't see anything. That's not too surprising because if they're black holes merging together, it's unlikely that you will form something that would give off optical light. However, in the future, LIGO will be sensitive not only to black holes merging, but also to neutron stars merging. And we think there's a good chance that when neutron stars collide together, they would give off optical light. So we will hopefully continue this program in the future and kind of piggyback on the survey that we're carrying out and synergize it with it in a nice way. And so our hope is that in the next year, perhaps, we may be able to discover optical counterparts for gravitational wave events for the first time. This is a picture of the Orion Nebula. This was taken with the Dark Energy camera. It has nothing to do with cosmology, but I thought it was a pretty picture. And this also has nothing to do with cosmology. This is a when we're pointing a computer tells us where to point the camera on any given time and any given night. Our computer doesn't know about comets. And so it happened to be this quite bright Comet Lovejoy, that was passing through while we took the picture. So it makes a nice pretty picture. All right, to summarize, the universe is about 13.8 billion years old. It's about 95% dark, 25% dark matter, which holds the galaxies and clusters together. There's going to be a quiz. About 70% dark energy. It's filled with billions of galaxies and clusters of galaxies that are mostly dark matter. It's expanding from a Big Bang. That was known for quite a while. For the last 18 years or so, we've known that that expansion is actually speeding up. We don't know why, but it's likely due to this dark energy, which makes up 70%. And with the Dark Energy Survey and other surveys that will follow on to it, we're embarked on this journey to address this mystery, to try to understand, learn more about the history of the expansion of the universe, and therefore hopefully learn more about the future evolution of life. Thank you. In four of the five filters, our exposures are 90 seconds long, so a minute and a half. In the very reddest of those filters, we expose for 45 seconds. So each time we expose, we open the shutter for 90 seconds, close it, move the telescope point in a different direction, open it for 90 seconds, close it. And so their individual exposures are 90 seconds. But as I said, over time, we come back and revisit each part of the survey field 10 times in each of the filters. So by the end of the survey, each part of the sky will be covered 900 seconds of equivalent exposure. Yeah, then we layer them on top of each other. Co-addition.
Thanks for another great talk. It seems like the total capacity of the universe is increasing. If that's correct, what happened to the law of conservation of energy?
Good question. So that's true. If dark energy is the dominant stuff in the universe, as I said, when the universe expands, the density of dark energy isn't going down. So therefore, so if the energy per unit volume is decreasing, if the volume is increasing, then the energy would be increasing. So what happened to the law of conservation of energy? Not true. Sorry. And actually, we've known that for going back way. So, in Einstein's theory of relativity, energy as a global quantity is not conserved.
Left hand side here.
Yes, at the beginning of your talk, you said the farthest objects are 30 billion light years away.
Yeah,
how can that
take.
Be if the universe is only 13.8 billion?
Yeah, I knew I was going to get that question. Good question. So it really comes down to how do we measure distances? And the point is, we measure distances with rulers or tape measures or something, right? That clearly doesn't work when I'm talking about things very far away. And so there are different ways to measure distances. So depending on those different ways of measuring distance, I can use the brightness of an object, I can use the apparent sizes of objects. And those can give me slightly different answers. So the 30 billion years was one using one particular measure of distance doesn't mean that that anything moves faster than the speed of light. It's just due to the fact that when I get to very large cosmic distance scales, it takes a long time to measure that distance. And so depending on how you define distance, you can get different answers. No, it's not inaccurate. It just means that when I get to cosmic distances, when I tell you the distance to something, I also need to tell you which distance I'm using. As long as I tell you which distance I'm using, it's fine. Trust me. You have mass or energy that creates a gravitational field, which exerts a force on any other sort, any other body moving in that gravitational field. So gravity is the thing that dark matter causes. Dark matter is just stuff. It's mass. It's something that has mass that is dark. Beyond that, we don't really know what it is. But it's not in itself a force. It is so in elementary particle physics, we have the basic particles of nature, the quarks. Those are the stuff that all matter that we see is made of. And then we have the interactions, the forces between them. And gravity, so we usually talk about the strong force, the weak force, the electromagnetic force, and then there's the gravitational force. And so basically, our picture of how physics works. That is elementary particles interacting via forces. Dark matter, we think, is likely to be an elementary particle. Gravity is one of the forces through which they interact. Sorry, microphone. Back here. does produce gravity. Any form of mass or energy produces gravity. But this is not the same as gravity. Back up here.
How close is our closest galaxy, neighbor?
How close is our nearest galaxy? Well, some of these very faint dwarf galaxies are only tens of thousands of light years away. The largest big galaxy to ours, the closest one comparable in size to the Milky Way, is Andromeda, and that's about 2 million light years away, give or take. Galaxies, the typical separation space of large galaxies is a few million light years.
So if we were trying to send a deep space mission to the Andromeda galaxy and the universe is expanding at 3,000 miles per second.
Okay, good question.
Wouldn't that put like you keep like cutting the distance in half every time and you never get there?
Yeah. Well, first of all, it would take a really long time. I know there's some people who are happy to go to Mars and not come back, but that would stay with them. So with Andromeda, I can sort of give you an answer without actually answering. So I said all these galaxies are expanding, moving away from our galaxy. And that's true of almost all galaxies. It's true of all distant galaxies. Andromeda actually happens to be gravitationally bound into a pair of galaxies with Milky Way. So actually Andromeda is approaching us. And we think that eventually Andromeda and the Milky Way collide and merge together in some number of billions of years. So actually if you wanted to just go to Andromeda, then you could just wait a few billion years. But it's true, if you want to go to other galaxies, then you have to go fast because they're moving away from us. But you can move faster. They're not moving faster than the speed of light, so we think you can get there. Left-hand side over here.
What's your favorite part of studying dark energy?
My favorite part?
Yeah. Why do you study dark energy? What got you started in it?
Oh, good question. Well, actually, what got me started studying dark energy was, in the training, most of my career has been as a theoretical astrophysicist. And there was sort of indications going back to the early to mid-1990s, before the supernova discovery, that things were not quite right, we already had sort of tentative evidence that this picture of a slowing down universe wasn't quite holding up. So it's sort of pre-evidence, if you like, for what we now know is acceleration of the expansion. And I had in my earlier career focused on, I mentioned in one of the slides that we think there was actually a much earlier epoch of very rapid expansion called primordial inflation. So we think a tiny fraction of a second after the Big Bang, the universe was also actually speeding up. And then eventually inflation ended and it went into a decelerating, slowing down expansion until dark energy. So we think that this is actually at least the second time in cosmic history that the universe is speeding up. And I had worked earlier in my career on some hypothetical ideas for what could be causing that earlier epoch of cosmic speed up inflation. And so, with some colleagues here, we started thinking about, could that same kind of phenomenon, I mentioned this very light, super light cousin of the Higgs boson, could that be causing the current epoch of cosmic speed up? So that's really how I got into this study. And then in the late 1990s, the discovery of the direct evidence for cosmic acceleration from the supernovae, got me into thinking about, how can we test this idea, how can we learn more about it? Theorizing is great, I love theorists, but there are certain times when you just need more data to really make progress in understanding something. And my judgment has been that in dark energy, we really need to do these kinds of surveys to point us in a particular direction.
question is related to your slide, which shows percentages of dark energy, dark matter, and normal matter over the course of 13.7 billion years. Now, the slide shows that originally there was 17% of regular matter. Now we have only about 5%.
Right.
How do you explain this reduction or, you know, in the amount of regular matter? Where it appears?
Okay, so basically,
going to the faint?
So the universe is expanding, and as any kind of, you know, if you have a gas that expands, right, it becomes less dense. The distance between